I'd like to start with a story. A few years back, when I started working at the state, one of their selling points was that they would reimburse education. At that time, I hadn't considered going back to get a master's yet, but I thought, great way to advance if I choose to do so in the future. Then I started digging. In order to use this program, there were some conflicting stipulations. It would only cover one class per fall or spring semester, up to a certain amount that you had to pay for up front. It also did not cover the costs of any books or associated labs. After the semester ended and you proved you had a B or higher, then the state would pay the school directly, who would then reimburse the student. On top of this, it had to be a class specifically associated with your current job, and that could take the entire semester to decide if that was actually the case, and it wasn't a guarantee. To even apply for most of the jobs, you had to either have the required degree or 3 years of relevant job experience per each year of college, so 12 years of relevant experience was equivalent to a bachelor's. Emphasis on relevant. In nearly all cases, only those with the required degree were hired, and rarely those with experience. So if you have the degree, then you can't use the program to pay to get a master's because you only needed a bachelor's, which you already have. This is only the start of all the required red tape, but I later discovered in a building with over 500 employees, only two qualified for the education reimbursement program. Those in the state legislature decided that since this wasn't being used, the program should be eliminated. It wasn't used because it wasn't designed to be used. It was designed to fail. So while people want more reliable public transportation, I think we need to keep things like this in mind because it needs to be designed in a way that it can actually be used. Quick note, the data cited when it comes to demographics such as gender is based on what was gathered and used in the process at that time. As things change, this will start to be reflected in the data as well. Keep in mind, when it comes to gathering data, depending on the topic, it can take 3 to 5 years to gather, analyze, and distribute results.
Ah, the old number 22. Clean, reliable public transportation. The chariot of the people. The ride of choice for the poor and very poor alike. Sure, some folks prefer...
You getting on this next bus, kid?
Yes.
Taxi!
Public transportation. It's a way to cut down on emissions, ease up congested traffic, and be a cheaper alternative to driving. However, that is very dependent on where you live and how it operates. In Russia, the metro in cities such as St. Petersburg, Moscow, Novosibirsk, and Volgograd are clean, efficient, run practically all day, and are heavily used. In Germany, you can choose transportation, such as the tram or bus, along with the rail or metro systems. Not to mention that the London buses are one of the most recognizable forms of transportation. In densely populated areas, it makes sense to use public transportation because it's a faster and generally safer way to go from one side of town to the other instead of driving. It's also much cheaper and generally doesn't use 4 hours of your day. When it comes to the United States, it's a mixed bag. The BART in San Francisco and the King County Metro in Seattle are relatively clean and safe, and I was able to travel to most of the places I wanted to go without issue. The New York Subway and Atlanta MARTA have mixed reviews. The first thing to point out is that these are major cities with a dense population. A public transportation system has a better chance of being maintained and usable here than in rural Montana. I'll link the video for non-public transportation here. For shows that don't take place in New York City, public transportation isn't necessarily a focus most of the time. In shows like Shameless, the majority of the time the characters are either using public transportation or walking. Before going further, I want to make it clear that this is not dismissing the importance of public transportation. This is just to point out some of the issues that exist and why a system in one place may not be successful in another, so that public transportation can be a reliable and safe alternative for more of the US. What works in Copenhagen may not work in Phoenix. A bus system that works in Houston may not have the same success in Branson. No system is perfect. For more in the series, feel free to like, subscribe, comment. For the poor, public transportation may be our only option, and it can take up a huge chunk of time that those with a vehicle don't have to think about. It's even harder for those in states with large rural areas that have less than 100 people per square mile. This video will include a couple examples from different cities, but these are just examples of the bigger picture, and mostly because the information available was readily accessible. Many cities have information about how to buy a pass, follow the schedule and basic rules, either available on site or online, and the Tulsa Transit in Oklahoma is one of these. Let's start with the route and schedule. Many jobs in retail, food service, or customer service can be stringent on when you report to work and when you get to take breaks or lunches. Now add in the stress of trying to determine which bus to take to work and when to make sure you get there on time. If everything is running on schedule, not bad. But if the bus runs late and it's out of your control, you can still get docked. There's also the question of timing. If a bus only comes around every half hour, this needs to be factored in, as well as delays from construction, inclement weather, holidays, or local events. If we look at the transit map for Tulsa, many of the major roads in downtown area have a bus that passes by or is close. However, this is only during the week, as a different map with different limited routes are available for nighttime and Sundays. Better Call Saul takes place near Albuquerque, so let's look at their transit. Again, we see different schedules for the weekday and weekends, and in some cases, Saturday and Sunday are different routes. In glancing at schedules, there's a bus about every half hour to an hour, assuming there are no delays. Ozark takes place in Missouri, and while there isn't mention of public transportation that I was able to discern in the show, let's go a bit up north and look at Columbia, where Mizzou is. There are 6 routes, and it is heavily impacted by the university, as that is the majority of people using it. Again, there's a bus about every half hour, and it runs mostly between about 6:30 a.m. and 6:30 p.m. Fargo takes place mostly in Brainerd, Minnesota, but let's look at Fargo, North Dakota. Again, many of the routes are influenced by students that attend the colleges in the area, such as North Dakota State University, Concordia College, and the Minnesota State University of Moorhead. Unlike Columbia, there are more routes that continue later into the evening, though there are buses every hour instead of every half hour. Let's say you work at a local grocery store, and you work the overnight shift because it paid almost $2 more an hour, since most people don't want it and you're mostly stocking shelves. Overnights, or third shift, can start anywhere from 10 at night to midnight. If there isn't any public transportation, you'll need to catch a ride, use a rideshare service or taxi, or if all else fails, walk or ride a bike. The end of the shift isn't as bad, since the buses often start running shortly after 6 a.m. However, there's another factor. What if you work one of the worst schedules, otherwise known as a split shift? For those lucky enough to not know, a split shift can be about 3 to 4 hours in the morning, with a 3 to 4 hour break followed by another 3 to 4 hour shift within the same 24-hour period, though those times can vary. It sucks. With public transportation, you already have to work around the bus schedule to figure out when to arrive and leave work twice, but now you have to do it 4 times. If you have errands to run, or a doctor appointment, that's not so bad, but it just throws off the rhythm of the day. And if you do work a split shift at night, aside from a bar or convenience store possibly being open, what will you do? Even if it's during the day, if you have to be on the bus stop 45 minutes before your shift starts and it takes about that amount of time to get home, that's 1.5 hours of that break between split shifts. And if it's a 4 hour break, that leaves 2.5 hours to try and fit something else in. I'll link a couple articles below, but essentially business owners benefit from split shifts more than workers do. If you Google information, there are several how-to guides for owners and the benefits to the company. As far as the employees themselves, there isn't much supporting them, and while there is an awareness that many are not fans of the split shift, there doesn't seem to be much in regards to finding a better solution. Transportation scheduling also factors into safety and more stress. If you're already waiting at a sketchy stop and you just happen to miss the bus, you now have to wait for the next one, which can be about a half hour to an hour or more. Not all stops for public transportation have any sort of shelter, and if you're waiting alone at a stop, you're kind of in a vulnerable position. If a store is nearby, you might be able to meander around a little waiting for the next one, but let's look at where some of the stops are in the routes that we've looked at. In this image of a bus stop in Tulsa, it's relatively clean and there's luckily a sort of shelter, but it's basically vacant of people aside from those driving. And in this one from Albuquerque, kind of in the middle of nowhere. Even this stop in West Fargo might be in the middle of buildings, but as a single woman, each of these makes me feel uneasy for different reasons. Until I was able to get a car my junior year, I had to take the bus and deal with stalkers more than once. If you need a bus and you're at one of these places with someone stalking you, where are you going to go? What if you can't get a phone signal? What if you got to the stop early and the bus is running 20 minutes late? When I was being followed, this added to the time and stress of public transportation, as I didn't want to get off at a stop near where I lived or where I worked. This means more time on the bus, and depending on the system, more money spent on the fare. If you get off at a different spot and walk, that's more time and you might be in a spot of town you are unfamiliar with. In the 2020 article from Metro Magazine linked below, quote, "Transit riders, and especially women, are often victims of a wide range of offenses of a sexual nature that happen on buses and trains, as well as at bus stops and train stations," end quote. Unsurprisingly, most incidents are underreported. In the article, they explained that the focus was mostly college students, and from looking at a couple of the cities in this video, that would be the majority of people using public transportation. It goes on to explain that nearly two-thirds experienced some form of harassment, with verbal being the most common. Safety concerns affected if students continued using public transportation, and these negative experiences had long-term impacts. Another point is that it explained that while both men and women were harassed, women were more likely to be affected and felt more unsafe. If you are struggling to make ends meet and have to use public transportation because you don't have a car or can't afford another option, that constant stress will have a negative impact on your health. For New York, the MTA has a webpage on safety for using the public transportation with tips such as avoiding empty cars, using entrances and exits that have activity, and using appropriate waiting areas. They provide numbers to call and forms to fill out. Let's add another caveat. What about those who are elderly or disabled? In some cases, there are medical insurance programs that pay for some transportation to go to and from doctor visits or retirement homes that provide services to common destinations. Sometimes the transportation is free or discounted, but not always. This expense can really chip away at retirement or savings over time. The elderly also spend more on medical expenses. In the 2016 article linked below from the National Center for Biotechnology Information, the elderly spend 2.6 times the national average on medical care, and between the ages of 70 to 90, those expenses double, largely due to nursing homes. While many are lucky enough to be able to drive as they continue to age, that is not the case for everyone. With this population comes issues such as the physical barriers that may come up in trying to get on the bus or moving at a slower pace. The Americans with Disabilities Act of 1990 prohibits discrimination on the basis of disability in public transportation services such as city buses and public rail, subways, commuter trains, etc. Navigating public transportation varies by city. For the disabled, this can make it more difficult when determining which stops may or may not have ramps if they're required, and being familiar with how to store medical equipment. Demographic-wise, in 2019, about 85% of people in the U.S. get to work by car, and about 5% use public transportation. Part of this is due to much of the United States needing cars to get to work because public transportation is limited or not available. The majority of public transportation use is in large metro areas and include New York City, Chicago, San Francisco, Washington, D.C., Boston, Los Angeles, and Philadelphia. The data also shows that overall, there's not a statistically significant difference between the number of men versus women who take public transportation. When accounting for different age groups, this remains the same, although there is a slight increase in the higher age groups for women using public transportation, though it is still not a statistically significant difference. However, for the identified large metro areas alone, there are more women using public transportation. Also, in the large metro areas, 52% are Black or African American, American Indian or Alaska Native, Asian, Native Hawaiian, or Pacific Islander, while in the rest of the U.S., it's about 46%. As far as income, in the large metro areas, it's mostly spread across the board. However, in the rest of the United States, about 45% of those using public transportation make $25,000 or less a year. If we add in the next income bracket, about 70% of those using public transportation make less than $50,000 a year, as opposed to roughly 49% in the large metro areas. Let's consider the people working for public transportation. As far as wages, they appear to be in the middle, though as far as standard of living, it varies state by state. In May 2020, according to the Bureau of Labor Statistics, the mean annual wage is $48,110 a year. When broken down by industry, the majority of workers in this job category work for local government, excluding school and hospitals, with a mean yearly wage of $54,330. Those states with the higher median wages correspond with the large metro areas, aside from Alaska and Hawaii. As far as accidents or crashes, Passenger cars and light trucks less than 10,000 pounds make up the majority of highway crashes. Being a driver or passenger in public transportation is safer when it comes to accidents, as buses have been less than 5% of the accidents each year for the last 20 years. Worker safety has started to become a concern as recent global events have created rising tensions. This is not new though, as noted in the Smart Cities Dive article linked below, quote, New York City bus driver MR was spat on by a passenger in 2012, so viciously that it covered her uniform and face. They thought about quitting after the incident, spending 19 months off work to recover and attend therapy. It wasn't the first assault for MR, who has driven for the Metropolitan Transportation Authority since 1999. In fact, it was her fourth. She was once attacked by a passenger who refused to move a baby stroller from the aisle, once assaulted by a man pretending to be an MTA employee, and also once had hot coffee thrown over her for accidentally missing a stop. There's not much we can do, she said. You either sit there and take it, or you try and fight back. And I know I'm not going to lose my life, so I won't fight back. I won't lose my life because I want to get home to my family. I just get beat up if that's what it calls for, end quote. The Transportation Workers Union of America President John Samuelson explained that, quote, You have a situation where service delivery in a public transit system in America has been plummeting both in quality of service and quantity of service, and what that leads to is a frustrated ridership. The uniformed bus operator then becomes the target, end quote. Public transportation workers need to feel safe as much as the riders do. There are several articles that share other stories about the treatment that public transportation employees receive, and many are violent. One part of this issue is the lack of access to mental health services, and many people are untreated or they don't have consistent medical care. In some cases, such as New York, employees have asked for more police in public transportation to try and mitigate some of these issues. This also factors into why routes might not run after a certain time. If it is not safe for workers to drive a bus through certain streets after 8, they will likely stop that route before then. When routes are limited, this affects those who need it the most. If the company is willing to work around bus schedules, that isn't an issue. But often, schedules for those working low-wage jobs are not consistent, and if you say that you can't work past 7, they may put you on the schedule till 8 anyways, and then you have to figure out a way to and from work. In shows like Shameless, these issues are almost background, just a fact of life. The rail through South Chicago might be unsafe, but it's more that that's just how it is. We can do better. The status of mental health needs improvement, for one. There are many other resources and videos that explain that better than I, so I will leave that to them. As far as routes, when it comes to more rural areas, there are some adjustments that need to be made. For instance, if 40% of the town works at the same factory, that company and local government can work together to create a system that runs at the most beneficial times of day to get employees to and from work, while also providing a service to those in the community. If we go back to Brainerd, Minnesota, their system is set up as more of a service where you submit your trip and the time, and as long as you are in the service area, you can make use of the public transportation. Since this is a less dense population, that makes sense to have a service that is more on demand, so to speak, and if it needs canceled, there is the cancellation form. There's a lot of sentiment toward increasing public transportation, and I think that's a good thing. We just need to make sure that it's built in a way that is usable, reliable, and safe. We can't just mimic what's in New York for every town and city and then wonder why it fails. The system needs to be set up in a way that works within the community it's serving. Until next time.